Rishikesh has also joined us.
Oh, hi Rishikesh. Hi Prabal, if you are there. Hi to all of you, in fact. Individually.
Yes. I thought you were sending her a private message. You
yeah. Okay.
Yeah, he sent me. Is this a threat or is it a request? Tara, is this a threat or is this a request?
It's a request.
Okay.
Your request is not conceded at all.
Just like you, Aparna, to say that. Okay. Welcome all. Very happy to welcome Dr. Aparna, Professor Aparna Lanjewar Bose, good friend, very valuable colleague and very accomplished colleague as well, who teaches in the EFL University. She's a trilingual poet, writer, critic, and translator, and also a professor in the School of Literary Studies in EFL University. She taught at the University of Nagpur, Mumbai University before joining EFL University. She specializes in American literature, African American literature, revolutionary marginal literatures, and contemporary women's writings. Her areas of interest and research include comparative literatures, African literature, Indian literatures, Dalit literatures, translation, folk literature, postcolonial diaspora poetry, and feminist writings. She has successfully guided many scholars to their doctoral awards and continues to mentor both MA and PhD scholars. She's been a resource person in several major national and international platforms, both in India and abroad. Her study towards research and social activism led her to visit several countries like Germany, France, England, Switzerland, Sweden, Zimbabwe. The list is very long. She was part of the Sahitya Academy Writers and Scholars Delegation to Moscow and Istanbul in 2009. Besides publishing several articles, papers, reviews, and translations in peer-reviewed journals, she has edited and introduced a volume of critical essays titled Writing Gender, Writing Self, Memory, Memoir, and Autobiography, published by Routledge. It has won the Galaxy International Foundation Award 2020 in Literary Criticism. She has published two books of poetry titled In the Days of Cages and Could You Be, a book of translations titled Red Slogans on the Green Grass. She has compiled and edited two books on Marathi short stories and poetry titled Pakshi Ani. I think this is the Marathi title. I think she'll be better able to pronounce it. Sorry, I don't want to mispronounce. Her forthcoming publication includes a collection of Marathi, Dalit, and tribal women poetry in translations titled Silenced Speak. Welcome, Aparna, to Talking Films Online. Very, very happy to have you here. And also thanks much for suggesting Court, a film that many of us have watched and did not at all mind watching again for this discussion. Welcome and over to you.
Thank you, Nikhila, for that generous introduction. And I have it's really a pleasure to be part of this Talking Films Online. I know you have been trying to rope me in for quite some time. And we all know how this year has been, pretty preoccupied emotionally, physically, and otherwise. I'm sorry I couldn't give you dates earlier, but better late than never. I'm very, very happy to be part of this discussion today. I also take this opportunity to say hello and welcome to all the Parksman's friends who have joined from Canada, US, poet friends who have to whom I've just forwarded this program and who have managed to take some time out. So without getting into all these formalities, I would rather embark on my talk on this Marathi film Court. It's a very interesting film, and it's not that one is kind of unaware of what usually transpires or sort of conspires in courtroom dramas, because as a genre, it has been quite dexterously worked upon in Indian cinematic culture. At times realistic, at times dramatic, even bordering to ludicrous melodrama with those long rolling speeches and dialogues and the arbitrary, almost hideous usages of me lord and my lord meant to kind of garner huge public applause. I think these have had a huge mass appeal, making the gullible almost believe into thinking that this is what a court really constitutes. However, most of us know how masses are deluded into its incredulous nature, only to sort of make it seem probable, at least till the time the film is being watched. The real courtroom proceedings are far from these hyperbolic, glamorized versions. Nevertheless, some experiments in court drama have proved to be intrinsically worthwhile, and we do come closer to real issues. Recent films like Section 375, Pink, Mulk do raise pertinent issues. However, the professional cast and crew comprising of veterans and seasoned actors never escapes one's notice. And with the interspersed, scattered, formulaic mixing that one discovers here and there, fearless, bold, committal, and real, they do look, they sort of operate within set trajectories that are still limited. And try as they may, they do not overcome, or rather cannot avoid, the tropes of eventually metamorphosing into success stories after prolonged court battles. There is something of the given in them. Robert Mulligan's coming of age film, To Kill a Mockingbird, which was set against the backdrop of racism, where the defendant is a black man wrongly accused of raping a white woman, or Steven Soderbergh's Eric Brockovich, about a woman who fought against an energy corporation giant, making it culpable for the Hinkley groundwater contamination. I mean, these are some of the most brilliant films that you come across. In fact, international cinema has made a brilliant breakthrough and have some of the most notable examples of real courtroom trials. Ziad Doueri's Lebanese film, The Insult, which came in 2017, renders a rather hard-hitting statement on modern Middle Eastern politics. The Irish UK 1993 film by Sheridan, In the Name of the Father, which is based on the story of Guildford pub bombings of 1974, where people were falsely accused, falsely implicated, or director David Munka's Czechoslovakian biographical film, Milada, that follows the life of the namesake politician hanged by the Communist Party of Czechoslovakia on fabricated charges of treason and conspiracy. Or let us take Oliver Skimmitt's South African film, Shepherds and Butchers, again, based on the namesake book and experiences of Chris Marnewick again. These are compelling, it's a compelling drama set in Pretoria of 1980s against the apartheid background. And there can be countless examples that can be cited. I think Chetan Tamhane's Court, which was released in 2014, was India's official entry for the Oscars under the Best Foreign Language Film category in 2016. Coming from a young debutante, the film represents literally and metaphorically the success of a low-budget homegrown film with no big glossy names to really boast of, and yet it dares to venture into the risky terrains of presenting a critique of antiquated, cryptic judicial laws and societal flaws, competing with mainstream heavyweights like Bahubali and PK to make it to the Academy Awards, and winning numerous accolades, of course, the National Award, the Golden Gateway Award, Gateway of India for Best Film in International Category, New Talent Award, Best Film Award, Best Director, to just name a few. I won't get into that list. For those of you who haven't watched the film, I'll try to just very briefly go through the, scan through the plot and then take the discussion further. It's about Narayan Kamle, the 65-year-old Dalit social activist, a folk singer, a tutor to young children, and who's a part of this troupe of performers who perform their gigs in and around Mumbai's insalubrious neighborhoods. And Narayan Kamble is arrested and charged of abetment of suicide of a sewage worker, Vasudev Pawar, who died choked in a manhole. It is alleged that one of the incendiary songs, which was sung by Kamble, spoke about the inhumane conditions, governmental apathy, corruption, bigotry, and unjust social system which drove the sewage worker to his death. The charge against Narayan Kamble reads as follows. On August 24, 2012, the body of Vasudev Pawar, 25, a Brihan Mumbai Municipal Corporation worker, was recovered from a sewage gutter in Andheri, East Mumbai. According to police, Pawar, a manhole worker, committed suicide by choking himself to death inside a sewer located at Ram Vilas Road. The police, after thorough investigation, have filed a case of abetment to suicide under section 309 of the IPC against Narayan Kamble. These workers are fully aware of the hazardous gases that breed inside the sewers. No manhole worker with the experience of doing the job for 5 years, like the deceased, would go inside the sewers without any kind of protection to eyes, nose, or skin. The investigation officer, Pradeep Shelke, said, no safety equipment was found on or near Pawar, and there were no wounds, injuries, or signs of struggle on his body. According to the police, Pawar was provoked to commit suicide by a performance rendered by Narayan Kamble and his troupe at Sitla Devi Nagar on 21st August. According to an eyewitness, one song performed by the accused coaxed and encouraged the manhole worker to commit suicide by deeply inhaling the toxic gases found inside the city sewers. Pawar's postmortem report was confirmed that the cause of death was inhalation of poisonous gases. Vasudev Pawar, a resident of Sitla Devi, is suffered by his wife and daughter. Well, this is the takeoff point, and as flimsy and as confounded this charge against Kamble is, this brief news item becomes the film's initiation point. What ostensibly follows is manifestly an absurdly ludicrous court trial. A case is filed and brought to the Court of Sessions Judge Sadavarte. The public prosecutor is Nutan, and Vivek Vora is the defendant attorney, played by Vivek Gombare, who also happens to be the producer of this film. Vora tells the court that the evidence is highly inconclusive, and he quotes from Halsbury's Laws of England, stating that the finding of suicide must be based on evidence of intention of the accused to aid, instigate, or to abet to commit suicide. That Kamble and Pawar did not know each other, had never met before. Public prosecutor Nutan states that the song in question suggested that the one and only solution for certain sections of the society to gain dignity and respect was to commit suicide. And that the song even suggested the method of suicide, the very same one by which the deceased took his life. She stays focused on Kamble's past record to weigh in on the current case, all of which is rather spurious. Vinay stays focused on the lack of evidence in the current case. The judge, who has a reputation of speedy disposal of cases before him, rejects the bail plea of Narayan Kamble and sets another date for trial. When the trial actually begins, one out of the two witnesses goes missing, along with his statement. And the other turns out to be a stock witness used by the police official named Shankar Boyer. He testifies that he saw the manhole worker singing Kamble's songs. In between the trial proceedings, there are succinct snapshots of other cases rendered. You have the case of stolen imported watch, hysterical case of Mercy Fernandez, passengers traveling in handicapped sections of the train, all of which really highlight the belligerency operative in a big nation with the sustained backlogs in courts, and really leave us with this rather disturbing realization that justice is fragmented and a forgotten cog in the giant wheel of this criminal justice system. We also get glimpses into the private lives of these two lawyers. And obviously after the testimony of Sharmila, who happens to be the widow of Vasudev, the defense lawyer, pleads on health grounds of his client and bail is granted with a surety of 1 lakh rupees paid by the lawyer himself. Obviously, next we see Kamble is while he's busy with the publication of his autobiography, The History of Humiliation, which is again picked up by the police on the charge. He's again picked up by the police on the charge of sedition. The investigating officer links him with an incarcerated man, Ashwin Bhagat, through a letter written by Bhagat to Kamble, and that accuses Kamble of planning illegal activity through the use of code language. The defense lawyer tells the court that Bhagat has only requested Kamble to take care of his ailing mother while in jail. The public prosecutor harps on the recoveries made from Kamble's house. A rather mundane letter gets into or turns into a damning piece of evidence, and two books banned, recovered from Kamble's house, lead to his hysterical perversion of facts. This time charged under Unlawful Activities Prevention Act for working with potentially dangerous individuals to threaten the unity, integrity, security, and sovereignty of India, of conducting seditious camps under the guise of folk artist workshops. It's a non-bailable offense and he's placed in judicial custody. Vora, obviously as the defense lawyer, pleads that the arrest might pose serious health risks, and being the last day of the sessions court, which would close for summer vacations, his client would unnecessarily be detained without trial. The judge merely tells him to take the matter to the High Court. The next thing that we know is the judge is on vacation, and the end is perhaps just the epilogue, because one just doesn't know what becomes of Narayan Kamble. Well, court says and shows a lot without wasting a moment. The film has no flab, and this despite the fact that it has these long shots that sort of linger long after the action is over. There are moments of meditation on what has just transpired, yet what you see, 70% of the film is shot in the courtroom and the police station that was sort of created. The rest, of course, was shot on location. Let us get into the sources of this film. The filmmaker's intention was to clearly show how a trial based loosely on inconclusive evidence can really turn into a nightmare for an innocent, hapless activist in an Indian setup. The idea of the film actually germinated from the filmmaker's own concerns as a concerned individual. It took concrete shape from a few borrowed sources, primarily from the case of cultural activist Jitain Marandi, hailing from the Adivasi tribe of Jharkhand. He was charged as the key accused in the Chilkari massacre of October 26, 2007, when 19 people, including the son of former Jharkhand CM, were gunned down by naxals at a public function. Marandi was given death sentence by the Sessions Court, further invoking the Jharkhand Crime Control Act 2002 against him. This arrest was followed by 6 years incarceration. The death sentence against him was obviously set aside later by Ranchi High Court in 2012 and then the Supreme Court in 2013. Interestingly, it transpired that he was arrested only because he shared a name with the Naxal commander. A leftist sympathizer and part of the network of tribal activities, he was quite vocal, loud and clear through music, debates, theaters, against the so-called developmental steel projects undertaken by ArcelorMittal, Jindal, SR, and such other groups, and very aware of the grim cost of displacement that would be faced by the marginalized. The second important source for Tammane's film is the state's badgering, hounding, and hunting of the members of progressive socio-cultural organization, the Kabir Kala Manch, who through their music, dance, poetry, would spread the message social awareness. The members of Kabir Kala Manch, like Sachin Mali, Dengle, Ramesh Gaichor, Sheetal Sate, Jyoti Jagtap, Sagar Gorkhe, these are mostly students and young activists from working class Maharashtrian backgrounds who vociferously verbalized against the ongoing Dalit atrocities, the truck patriarchy, communalism, the farmers' distress, and became more proactive, particularly after the Gujarat riots 2002. They were arrested under the draconian Unlawful Activities Prevention Act, UAPA, And in 2011, they were accused of promoting the Naxal Maoist ideology. In fact, some of them were granted bail in 2013, while some were detained. Lawyers and activists like Mihir Desai, Vijay Hiremath, Devyani Kulkarni in the High Court, and Jawahar Raja and Rebecca John in the Supreme Court represented their cases. Incidentally, a few members were again arrested by the NIA in connection to the Bhima Koregaon case for making provocative speeches at the Elgar Parishad in Pune in 2017. Now, this was one glaring example of how the state pronounced cultural activists as terrorists, as Maoists, when they questioned its functionaries. The filmmaker attended many of these court trials to see through the redundancy and the arguments that were postulated by the state. He educated himself in the world of protest music and the legal world by tagging himself along with Sambhaji Bhagat, who also used to remain present during the trial of these youngsters, as he himself was a member, active member associated with Kabir Kalam Manch. In fact, Sambhaji Bhagat has provided the poetry and the music that you have in this film. The other most important source for the filmmaker, obviously, was the documentary by Anand Patwardhan, Jai Bhim Comrade, which was based on this whole thing. The film's source for the primary story of the death of sewage worker came from the write-up by S. Anand titled Life Inside a Black Hole, which was published in the Tehelka magazine, volume 4, issue of December 8, 2007. Tamhane takes a cue from French photographer and documentary filmmaker Robert Depardon's cinema verite and direct cinema style. Now, some of you are aware the cinema verite is this truthful cinema. It's primarily a style which is sort of characterized by realistic, typically documentary films which sort of avoid the artifice and the artistic effect and are generally made with minimalist equipment. It sort of combines improvisation using the camera to unravel the truth or to highlight the subject hidden behind the crude reality, while direct cinema, of course, is a cinematic practice that employs lightweight filming equipment, handheld cameras, and live synchronous sounds. This gives the filmmakers a chance to sort of do away with large filming crew, studio sets, and special lighting effects in the making of the film, and also sort of cuts down on the cost of production. Both obviously rely on the power of editing to shape and structure and give meaning to the material recorded. Similarly, Tamhane's film draws heavily from the Polish filmmaker Krzysztof Kieślowski's film, The Office, which sort of presents this intense bureaucracy existing in the Polish government services and with people being turned away for various violations. Tamhane's motivation to work with non-professional cast and crew, as you know, that most of them are non-professionals acting for the first time. This motivation came from Iran's foremost filmmaker, auteur Abbas Karyotsami, who would normally cast non-professionals alongside more refined actors just so as to have greater semblance through those amazing long takes that in a way also rendered that much pronounced tenderness to his films, thus making his subjects more valid and film laced with more authority and authenticity. A few other films that sort of immediately come to my mind for making exceptional use of untrained actors in the lead roles are Roma, obviously Alfonso Cuarón, Capernaum, Nadine Labaki, and The Shoplifters by the Japanese filmmaker Hirokazu Korida. And whether it's an American filmmaker, Stanley Kubrick, German filmmaker Werner Herzog, or Belgian-French filmmaker Agnès Varda, the use of non-professionals serves a great purpose. Of course, the trend we all know began with Sergei Eisenstein, and later it sort of got expanded to this whole group of Italian neorealists, Vittoria De Sica, Luchino Visconti, Rossellini, who in a way sort of rejected many of these conventional paradigms in cinematic movement by taking to the streets, shanties, to sort of capture raw injustice, oppression, poverty, and imbuing their social critique with severe authenticity. And of course, from where our great filmmaker Satyajit Ray actually took of himself for his own magnum opus and exacted perhaps the most extraordinary performance from the most ordinary non-professional actors. Tamhane's quote does the same, like Usmane Sembene's films quotes a controversial subject, at least in the present day context, to sort of bring out these real incidents, real locations, real people. If we go through the characters, you find, of course, Narayan Kamble's role is played by Veera Sathidhar. Vinay Vora, the defense lawyer, is Vivek Gombair. Nutan is Gitanjali Kulkarni. She's a product of NSD. Vivek Gombair, also, we have seen him in Sir and this Netflix series, Bombay Begums. The judge, Sadavarte, is Pradeep Joshi, a first-timer. Sharmila Pawar, the wife of the deceased Vasudev Pawar, is Usha Bane, again a first-timer. Narayan Kamble, Veera Sathidhar, again a non-professional actor. What is interesting is the characters speak for themselves. Tamhane doesn't interfere in the narrative schemata. Rather, he allows the characters to unfold themselves right before our eyes so that this bend of unpredictability is left wide open. The characters are not dramatis personae, so to say, in the stricter sense, but they are these normal individuals we kind of encounter in our day-to-day lives. They are people we surmise on a regular basis. They are flawed like all of us. They are layered individuals having multiple other facets to their primary selves. And this is reflected, of course, in the courtroom. The defense lawyer is a well-educated, well-placed criminal lawyer who fights human rights cases, perhaps fights these cases for his clients free of cost. We get to know that he's a founder member of an NGO and he's a member of that global elite club who sort of love participating in talks on social responsibilities. At the very start, we know he makes a jibe at sedition by referring, you know, I don't want to get into that conversation, but a very quicker where he says, he says Constitution believes in right to life, and today the greatest violation of, or the single most violation of this right is seen. Such conditions are being created that are not conducive or suitable for survival. There is another word for such condition, but if I say more, I will be charged of sedition, unquote. He lives alone, enjoys shopping for cheese and wine in a plush upscale supermarket, loves listening to jazz, drives a sedan, indulges in the company of chic friends in ritzy pubs, listening to performers performing in English, Brazilian songs. You know, he's rather calm, level-headed, self-assured at the court or with his clients, but seems agitated, aggressive at home with parents. Coming from this wealthy Gujarati background, he can afford being the people's champion. Vivek Gombair, who's also the producer of this film, has charted his role really well. Coming to the public prosecutor, she's this middle-class Maharashtrian woman doing her routine chores, carefully delving into her legal work, travels by local train, discusses latest fashion trends, domestic affairs with the train mate, picks up her son from daycare, cooks for the family, serves her diabetic husband and children while watching TV. She is that way a little closer to Narayan Kamle's world, but utterly, utterly disconnected. In terms of class, perhaps, she's closer to those whom she prosecutes. Her concerns are rather different, and so is her politics. Very casually, she remarks to her colleague that, I quote, "Judge should pass the judgment soon. Simply put the accused in jail for 20 years and just finish the matter," unquote. So people like Kamle are a nuisance for her. She laboriously reads out from obsolete laws, relying on one sole witness who we also know eventually turns out to be a stock witness planted by the police themselves. She is rather insular, but maybe not wicked or cruel or not the villain here. Occasionally, she enjoys lunch with her family at a moderate restaurant. Restaurant watches play with a lot of migrant and North Indian bashing. I think she's deferential to authority, rather dismissive of those below her. And I would draw your attention to a little conversation, that we have here, where she's talking to the lawyer, and she's saying, "These people she says there were 40 books seized from Narayan Kamble's home, to which Vora says, one is a manuscript called Goimari Manas by Sant Kashinath, written in 1899, and the other is a book, The Lotus and the Robo, by Arthur Koestler. It's about Oriental yoga. Goimari Manas is about the history of Goimari sect. Yeah, but it is banned because it hurts the sentiments of Goimari and offensive. The lawyer tells her that book was banned 110 years ago, and in its line, it was considered a very accurate critique of some regressive Goimari practices, to which the public prosecutor, the lady, says, it may be regressive for you, but for them it is still sacred. Yes, but still harmful and irrational, says the lawyer, to which she says, how can that be? This is very insulting. So, you know, this really shows you how dismissive she is. And this role, of course, is essayed so well by Gitanjali Kulkarni, an NST product, and she's adequately balanced her body language, mannerisms, way of speaking in English with that Marathi tone, you know, really well. Justice Sadavarte in his, is rather a partner in crime to this public prosecutor. He is a totally superstitious person, believer in numerology. He cuts the court session short, assigns dates to the lawyers, perhaps. The judge and the public prosecutor inhabit the same world, speak and understand the same language, go by the same obsolete rule book, adhere to the same reprehensible upper caste status quoism. There is an aspect about their lives about which they are stuck up, and perhaps being in the system for too long, they appear rather bored and jaded in this system, while Vora is the brother outsider for whom Marathi has to be translated, often in the courtrooms. So, and then of course we have Sharmila Pawar, played by Usha Bane, who's this grim, timid widow of the deceased sewage worker, Vasudev Pawar, who's caught in this legal battle, much against her wishes. And she's nervous. She refuses monetary help from the lawyer when he offers to help her out. Instead, she asks him to get him some work. But it is her testimony which sort of gives and brings life, or that brings to life Vasudev Pawar. One doesn't really conjectures to know the cause of his death. The cockroach test is explicitly retold by her to the court, and her testimony proves really crucial to actually get Kamble the bail. Now, this woman who has never acted before, Usha, and the picture of Vasudev Pawar that you have is actually the picture of her deceased husband, Dilip, who was an ambulance driver who fell from the train and died. So this is like a weird similarity of her struggles as a widow, both in real and real. So I'm just going to draw your attention to this little dialogue that you have, where the judge asks her, where were you? And she says, hometown. How come you left? Your husband died. No one came to claim body after autopsy. When did you return? Why did you go to hometown? She says, because I was scared. With whom? She says, brother-in-law, daughter. Now don't leave without telling like this. Her reluctance is clearly visible. Then the public prosecutor, Nutan, asks her, since your marriage is to Vasudev, since when have you been married to Vasudev? Since when has been he doing the work of cleaning gutters? She says, since marriage. He was used to these jobs, right? She nods ahead. There were no accidents or injuries. She says, he lost one eye. How? Don't know, she says. How was your husband's mental condition? As in, she asks, would he be happy or sad? He was okay, she said. Didn't he fight? He did. Would he beat you? Sometimes, she says. Beat the kids? Yes. Did he speak of suicide? No. Did he mention any song? No. About any man called Narayan Kamble? No. I mean, I think this is then of course the circumstances that she gives, the surrounding the death of her husband. Vora, the defense lawyer, asks her, would your husband wear something to cover his mouth, eyes? She said no. Gumboots, masks? No. How would he enter the gutters? He would just enter, but inside it must be full of dirt and stench. Yes, he would look for cockroaches. As in he would throw pebble inside the gutter if a cockroach or a bug came out, he knew it was safe to go in. How do you know this? He would say sometimes, the cockroach didn't come out today, so it is a holiday. What would he use to clean the gutters? Anything like a spade or rod? Wasn't he given anything else? No. How did he lose his eye? Couldn't understand properly. The doctor said, it was because the dirt that went in his, because of the dirt that went in his eyes. I mean, did he consume alcohol? Yes. How many times? Before or after work? Before work, to bear the stench of the gutter. No safety equipment was provided. Had to rely on alcohol to stand the stench in gutters. Had no reliable way of knowing if there was enough oxygen inside. And lost an eye due to infection. That's the inference. Now, friends, as per the latest WHO reports, millions of sanitation workers in developing countries, India, of course, being one of the leading ones, and especially in the ever-bulging, teeming metro cities like Mumbai, sanitation workers are forced to live in the most degrading, dehumanizing conditions that endanger their health and lives and violate their dignity and human rights. They are often the most marginalized and discriminated against in society. Most of the times, they carry out this work with absolutely no equipment, protection, security, or with no legal rights. Cleaning toilets, emptying pits, septic tanks, cleaning sewers, manholes. They are kind of directly exposed to human waste, poisonous gases that aggravate health hazards and diseases. Working with no consistent pay or no pay at all, it is true that many of these challenges encountered by the sanitation workers stem from the very fact that they lack visibility, being a much socially stigmatized work. Obviously, with the pandemic, their exclusion and vulnerability has only aggravated, and despite calls or initiatives to sort of for acknowledging them as COVID warriors, such calls or initiatives have not really gone beyond tokenism. And just for information, that despite the guidelines of the Ministry of Health and Family Welfare and the Central Pollution Control Board that includes mandatory use of PPE, that is the personal protective equipment, the recent reports show, they just hint the otherwise. These PPE kits are either not provided or are far from being adequate. Moreover, the scope of these guidelines covers only certain categories of sanitation workers involved in public health, healthcare facilities, diagnostic centers, quarantine centers, etc., thus totally bypassing certain other essential categories. Now, coming to the main character, Narayan Kamle, he's this aging Dalit activist of leftist leaning, a folk singer, performer, a mill worker who got laid off without any pension after the mill shut down. He takes tuitions, visits bastis and slums where he tries to spread awareness through his protest songs against all forms of oppression to anyone and everyone who is listening. Neither he nor his troupe get paid for their performances. He's a man who speaks his mind out, and he's charged of a crime he has not committed. He's obviously the victim of the judicial loopholes, legal violence, and bad misinterpretations of law. Later, of course, he's held under the fabricated charge of sedition, and he's perhaps the most hated, most undesired by the state and public authorities, who at best want a good riddance of the likes of him because they raise too many questions. Therefore, they are constantly on a prowl to sort of nab him this way or the other. And those two fairy and powerful songs that you hear at the start. Perhaps we can, perhaps I can just give a quick glimpse of it. Is there an option to sort of present here?
Yeah. I have enabled share screen, Aparna.
All right. So anyway, I would be ending up spending a little more time on that. So I'll rather skip. We all have seen that beautiful song sequence that you have right at the start, where he speaks of knowing your enemy. You know, it's a very very volatile very, very provocative song. So what is interesting is aspects of Tamasha Povada, which is the Maharashtra's folk form, has been very vibrantly used. And of course, Povada by itself is a very vibrant and intrinsic part of the Tamasha tradition. Quite obviously, the protagonist Narayan Kamble, is a folk artist, and therefore, the Povada form, or rather should I call it the Jalsa, has been brilliantly exploited to present the filmmaker's vision. Usually the writers of this Povada were called the Shahirs, and Maharashtra has this very rich Shairi tradition, you know, very glorious Shairi tradition. And it goes dates right back to the Peshwai rule and even before that. Well, if I start talking on that, it would probably form a separate lecture altogether, and I don't want to get in that. But having said this, I, however, need to add that the poetry of the Shahirs was based on popular subjects known to the common masses, as they were men who were engrossed in folk life, and therefore, very flawlessly, they rendered the joys, sorrows, and frustrations of their audience, with of course, the culmination of the Peshwai rule in Maharashtra and the establishment of Satyashodhak Samaj under the influence of Mahatma Jyotirao Phule. This Shairi tradition underwent a more realistic change, I must say. The purpose was not entertainment only, but sort of spreading social consciousness. And then there were these active groups operational to disseminate socially relevant messages to sort of bring out a more meaningful change in society. These artists belong to the underprivileged sections of the society, and the songs that they created were not created in some sort of artistic isolation merely to sort of satisfy some inspirational muse or composed out of social fashion, but rather they were fashioned by the needs of the times. There was a changed socio-political context, and artists sort of confronted this change by remaining within the Povada tradition and yet sort of creating something different. In the 20th century, of course, with the patronage of Chhatrapati Shahu Maharaj, you had some of the finest Povada artists like Bhimrao Oturkar, who was the first in 1910 to start with this, Satyashodhak Povada, then Mukundrao Jadhav, Bhaskar Jadhav, Mukundrao Patil, Karmavir Bhaurao Patil. I mean, these people became, they sort of made it an established platform for mass awareness. With the rise of course, the anti-untouchability and anti-caste, anti-class movement under the influence of Ambedkar, the Jalsa was born with a renewed vision and a renewed purpose. It was a revolutionary breakthrough for the marginalized communities to voice their angst. Activists like Shahir Bhimrao Kardak, they began to make pleas to sort of abandon these caste-based occupation and join the movement for dignity. They were not part of popular imagination, since the means and sources of cultural production obviously remained the monopoly of a handful of privileged castes and classes. But in a way, the Dalit movement in Maharashtra reinvented the Shahiri tradition. Modern day Shahirs adapted the old framework of Tamasha Povada to voice socio-political issues. Notable Shahirs include Shahir Amar Sheikh, who happened to be the father of Namdev, father-in-law of Namdev Dasar. You had Shahir Sabre, who was the father-in-law of one of a very, amazing actors. I always admired him, Ajit Vachani, and then Vithal Umap. And of course, there were many others who sort of enriched this tradition. So the performative role of narrativization in song, thus we gradually saw a very rebellious, revolutionary approach. In fact, both these forms gave the experience of marginality that much needed space in the realm of folklore and music. And it established itself as a significant culture of its own. These Shahirs, they wrote the songs and sang them too. Simplicity was the benchmark of these songs, and their performances explicitly detailed the history of emancipatory movement from, of course, the Brahminical paradigms and their world. Their words proved like piercing shafts, which interrogated the given. They ruptured notions of hierarchy, endorsing liberty, equality, and fraternity in the performative role of of this narrativization cannot be really denied. These, in fact, the music and the lyrics for the film Court comes from Sambhaji Bhagat, who is one of our contemporary living shairs. And the character of Narayan Kamle is based on Sambhaji. The filmmaker has shown how traditional folk can become effective as a means for rendering agency to silenced narratives and forbidden discourses, enough to be charged as libelous and seditious, and meaningfully underscores how those who assail and disagree with the system can be hauled and lugged under fake cases. In Narayan Kamle, we see the cruel fate of most of the mill workers in Maharashtra driven to destitution, their children into deprivation and their wives into prostitution. In him, we visualize the life of the folk artists driven to penury, who are now forced as much to share the stage space with cheap filmy performances that sort of animates the audiences more than folk performances. The pivotal role of Narayan Kamle is enacted by Veera Satidhar, who passed away very recently due to COVID complications. A very fearless poet otherwise, lyricist, cultural activist, journalist, an editor of this Marathi magazine, Vidrohi, which used to come out from Nagpur, from where I hail, and very closely associated with the Dalit Panther and anti-caste movement. He was led by his leftist ideology. He worked as a worker in a factory, organized labor force, gave up on his last name to attach Satidar, meaning comrade, to his name. He performed the Ambedkari Jalsa for enlightening the masses, and was an expert in sculpture, painting, besides acting. Precisely why I feel he didn't need to act the role, because he was Narayan Kamle himself. So he continued to live in a rented house till his last breath. That was the tragedy of Veera's life. But in this scathing indictment of antiquated, archaic legal system, Tamhane sort of humanizes, empathizes, rather lampoons his characters, primarily keeping his very humane and rational approach intact. I think it borders on this anti-genre. The film takes this very attitude into account to speak to people, because the film is about people who are part of this systemic structure and who comprise the system. So then judiciary just happens to be one aspect for it, because it's more of structural failings and human failings, be it for that matter, any institution with authority. In a metropolis which is teeming with divergent lives, viewpoints of people from varied cross sections of society and human populace, the court, in a way, becomes a melting pot, a place for convergence of people and ideas. And with a subtle grasp on these layered aspects, the film, in just 2 hours, conveys many things. It's a drama created out of the humdrum monotony of routine, ordinary lives, grappling with their own personal issues, but whose perceptions, attitudes, individual biases do affect the lives of others. There is nothing normative or prescriptive, detailing that, there is no caricaturing either. What you find rather is what the film sort of exposes the world as it is, without the usual artifice of trial dramas that sort of move around preordained tropes, exaggerations, and these larger than life presentations. His eye for perfection, poignancy, profundity ameliorates both content and technique, along with the music, the sets, the look of his characters, their costumes. So I think his conviction to go by his intuition remains unfazed by the fact that it is a repetitive genre, and he would be going against the grain. But with its sheer simplicity, perhaps, he was aware that it would have a relatively small audience, and with a tight budget, of course, but with a seemingly obvious commercial, lackadaisical approach that may put him in a tight spot, but with a very clear understanding of content and avant-garde techniques, he has rendered a very, very radiant, brilliant promise, I must say, in this otherwise glitzy, murky business of courtroom sagas. I'm going to look at a few aspects of this film.
Aparna, just a moment, if I may intervene at this point. Generally, we like to open it out for discussion after about 40-45 minutes.
Okay.
So we'll do that, and then you can come back to make your point, if you don't mind, Aparna.
Not at all.
Okay.
I'm fine with that.
Okay. Yeah, so anyone who wants to come in at this point, I had specially invited Rishikesh, who teaches film studies, my colleague in the department, who's also written extensively on Marathi cinema. I had also invited Professor Chandrakant Langare. One of them could come in at this point. Or anyone else either. I mean, if anyone else is ready to intervene now, most welcome. Chandrakant sir, yes, please go ahead. Yeah.
It was very enlightening and brilliant deliberation. But I wonder why you just mentioned that this is not a trial or a courtroom drama, but it is taken like that. I mean, this film is brilliant. All dimensions are very, as you rightly pointed out, they're fitting one in the Awaga kind of presentations and all cinematic rendition. But how come, I mean, I wonder that it's not a courtroom. What you would like to talk about it?
Did I make that statement that it's not a courtroom drama?
No. But it is taken as, I mean, it is, in fact, maybe the audience, on the part of the audience, maybe that is a wrong perception. I agree with you, strongly agree with you. It can't be termed as courtroom drama, but unfortunately it is taken like that, even at intellectual circles, within the intellectual circle. So what could be the reason why it is, it is not perceived that way? So what do you think? What is the reason?
I don't think I've made a statement of this nature where I say that it's not a courtroom drama. I'm, on the contrary, I'm trying to endorse the conviction of Tamane to go by his intuition, to remain unfazed, even in the wake of knowing that it is a repetitive genre that he would be using. That's what I said.
Okay.
Yeah, I think you
got it. Is it about the politics of evil or politics of evil in judiciary? So what do you
there
think?
Is a lot that I have not yet covered, in fact, and Nikhila, since she has asked me to hold for a moment, perhaps if the whole entire lecture is heard to, then perhaps I may be able to respond more efficaciously, I feel.
No doubt that we are enlightened. I mean, your deliberations, I very much liked it because it is, I mean, really, I mean, it has added many dimensions to our perception. I'm not a film studies scholar, but I realize that, as you rightly pointed out, it is really a film that can create woe even at the international arena. But I wonder why it is not, though it was, I think, nominated for such a higher, endowment. And
there are many, many layers to this film. I only hope that I'm able to cover those things that I have in mind to before I sort of comment on.
I would say that it is deserving one to get that kind of award and but still I wonder why. I mean, this is a very common run of question of a common run of audience like me, part of that audience that. After watching this film, I realized that it should have it should have been awarded with such a great honor. So this is what I felt.
Thanks, Professor Chandrakant Langare. Rishikesh, do you want to come in at this point?
Hi, Nikhila.
Hi.
Hi, Aparna.
Hi, Rishikesh.
So really, very elaborate and a very persistent discussion that you have initiated, Aparna. Thanks a lot. In fact, court is a film which needs to be discussed or talked about in many different circumstances, and not just in the circumstances of genre or, you know, in terms of politics or something like that. It's one of those films which comes once in, say, 3-4 years, and it presents a well-rounded kind of a critique of the system. And it takes the system as the starting point, and then helps us to go deeper and peel the layers, as you were trying to say. So thanks a lot for initiating that discussion. I just have one small kind of, I guess you would cover that point later on in your talk, but one small point which I felt many people kind of tend to put it in a generic perspective. The fact that this film came and made waves within certain circles, that fact that it posited a kind of a newness in that sense, was to do with Chaitanya's insistence of putting the narrative at a crossroads. So there are these three or four narratives, and these narratives are essentially emanating from the characteristics of the characters. Mm. So the lawyer, Veera Satyadhar, the judge, as well as the minor actors in the film, even the parents for that matter of the lawyer, are in that sense, they have a pre-story, they have a role to play. And in a way, court is not just about this very, very important discourse about law.
No, it isn't. Yes.
It actually takes it as a starting point.
Yes.
To help us, look at the way that certain worlds coexist without the knowledge of one to the other. And this is one of the critiques that I guess Chaitanya has in mind when he, for example, Vivek's character, the lawyer. You know, he's shown to go to a pub and have a kind of an elite intellectual social life.
He's part of that global elite right. club, you know, who enjoy their evenings, who help. But then the question is, what about the middle class mindset? I mean, is it just the well-off who are compassionate to the poor? Speaking about Nutan, who seems to be more closer to Narayan Kamble in terms of social status, you find she's absolutely not empathetic or rather stickler to rules, and so is the case with the judge. But there are many layers, as you've rightly pointed out. Perhaps I can throw light on some of those.
Right. The second small little point which emanates from this is the style that Chaitanya adopts, and then he's continued now with his new film, The Disciple, which some of you must have had an opportunity to watch on Netflix.
Yeah.
So there is a consistent trajectory there, one coming from obviously the slow cinema kind of aesthetics, as you said, Kiarostami and Kieslowski and others.
Yes.
But in the contemporary sense, you see, Alfonso Cuarón is one of the is an executive producer for The Disciple, and he was on the sets of Court as well when it was being shot for a brief while in Bombay. Chaitanya Tamne spent a lot of time on the sets of Roma.
Yes.
So there is this, there is this sense of, let's say, solidarity of aesthetic views,
yes,
or of an aesthetic vision, which somehow had got lost in the intervening years, at least for Indian cinema.
Yeah.
So that is something heartening to note in Tamne's work. Yeah, So just these two bits, and
I think the cinematography, the camera, the editing part. I mean, Mrinal Desai, who has done the cinematography, he has this added experience of working with Danny Boyle, you know, in Slumdog Millionaire. So I think his wide-ranging experience also of working with multiple other people across cultures, styles, you know, and technologies really stood in good stead for Tamani's venture. The outcome, of course, is not the rushed up, snappy, hurried kind of glimpses, but there is this rather patient waiting that you find that is enough to make the audience participant, you know, voyeurs. So what is interesting also is each shot is kind of photographed. Each image that you have is deliberately cut out. I mean, Tamani virtually plants you into those scenes and events even before you realize it consciously. And what is, you must have noticed how the camera sort of spans and lingers before the idiosyncrasies of the characters kind of unravel themselves. And you are not even able to grapple the pace of it. You know, the terrains all worked out, whether the camera movement is outside the session spot or it is following on the road or the bus ride, the train ride or the courtroom or the private spaces of the characters like kitchen, pub, spa. I think the scenes, the events are very leisurely allowed to precipitate even after the camera moves for another shot, giving just adequate time to the audience to sort of understand and accept and gauge the discrepancies, whether and sort of formulate a kind of perception of what stirs him up or her, you know. So what is interesting, again, I find, which makes its impact, is the camera never strays. We are not shown the manhole or the gutters, you know, or even the sewage worker in question. Though everything about the film really borrows its reference from that source, we are not even shown as to what becomes of Kamle in judicial custody. You know, that these are open-ended things. Rather, we are all given the outcome of it all. And the response of the people is connected with the case and the person concerned. And to me, that is the aesthetic, you know, appeal underlying the film. Not only are you not expected as audience to be active participants, but it is demanded of you by Tamani, you know. And I think the remarkable patience behind the camera with these minimal shots, you find that there are very few scenes with different angles. The camera in the courtroom seems fixed. There is this reticence which is overkilling sometimes, very surplus, but it's also very saintly, very meditative. And that seems only justifiable in the film. The stylistic intent that you were talking of, Shukesh, is to sort of impart that, I feel, that much needed objectivity as possible. And those long shots do convey that nothing that we see is exceptional. In fact, Kamle's arrest tells you that he has been arrested before, you know, it's the given. So the wide shots deployed in the courtroom do endorse this routine business. And the same objective approach gives us a peek into the lives of all these the folk singer, the defense lawyer, the prosecutor, and judge.
A couple of people have unmuted themselves, Vijay Borati and also Geeta Vishwanath. Geeta first and then Vijay Borati.
Yeah. Thank you, Nikhila. Aparna, thank you for your very interesting opening up of the film for discussion. Since you just brought in this topic of the camera work, I thought what was very interesting was, you know, the way the entire scene is set up, and then the subjects are just waiting, you know, to enter the frame. For instance, the very first time in the film where we see Vora, this lawyer, his first entry into the narrative is in that police station scene. And what is very interesting here is the background, the way the sound is designed. The background sounds are not muted.
No.
And, you know, like you don't have any accompanying music or anything to show, you know, that this is the entry of the hero. On the contrary, you have this very interesting conversation between those two police women, you know, going on there. And, you know, if you strain a little, you can actually even catch their conversation and what they're talking, they're discussing about, you know, some kind of a domestic thing that they are talking about. So that I thought was very interesting. And another thing is the ending of the film, you know, the end ending with this with the holiday of the judge, but which was completely unexpected. In fact, I thought the film had ended when that guy, you know, winds up everything in the courtroom and then he shuts the switches off the light and shuts the door, and you have what you have been saying now about the lingering camera on that darkness. You know, and that was a very symbol, and one would think that's a very symbolic end as well. But then suddenly, you know, you have this very happy scene of this picnic and everybody, children and women and men all going out on a in the bus for a picnic to a resort.
Yeah.
And then you wonder, you know, like what is this? What's happening here?
Yeah.
And then you realize that, you know, there is such a sharp irony, you know, to this whole end, because then you get to know that this is a judge who is, you know, who just believes in numerology, and then you begin to wonder, like, was he in the, you know, was he in a position to even sit in that judge's chair?
Yeah.
And another thing about the ending is, like, for the judge, that case was just, you know, part of his work. And he can, you know, go on a vacation and enjoy himself without really being, you know, bothered about the impact of his judgment on other humans. That was one. And Nikhila, can I just make one more point, or should I think I should come back later? That will be
okay. No, go ahead, Geeta. Go ahead.
Okay, okay. Another thing I thought very interesting was these A-sides, like A-sides, you know, the lawyers' lives, both of them, that is shown. And at the same, in literature, we call it the showing and the telling technique. So if we could extrapolate that to a cinema, then these scenes are shown. So, you know, the lives of these lawyers are shown. Whereas the life of the widow of Pawar is told to us. You know, we are told that she's gone off because she's afraid of what can happen to her, to her family because of the sudden death of her husband and the possibility of a police case. So it is like, you know, like she is denied agency in narrating her tale. She can only be told about. And that, I think, is a reflection of the caste divisions as well.
I think, Nikhila, can I would ask your permission now. Should I?
No. Go ahead.
I'm done. Please go ahead.
This is a very important and very interesting point that has been brought out by Geeta. In fact, the use of silences that you find in this film, these silences tend to speak. It has been used with adept dynamism. What I found interesting is there is this involvement in every scene, yet there is this uncanny, noticeable detachment. There is no dramatic outpouring or raptures, for instance, you know, the Vora father, you know, mother scene at home, or Sharmila Pawar, as Geeta has mentioned, and her interaction with the in the court with a lawyer. These silences speak a lot otherwise, and sort of tend to fill the gaps of unwanted arbitrary dialogues, or you know, or are ruptured only when the natural flow of dialogues which are there not otherwise. So within these silences, these characters express their rage, they pause, they plead, argue, feel confused, baffled, like one would in normal circumstances. So these silences that have been used by Tamane render very find perception and speak the unspoken. The use of quietitude, I think, has always been a very important tool to quantify the audience reaction. That also further depends on the narrative style, on what narrative style dictates, you know. Like, for instance, most of these Martin Scorsese films, which tend to sort of create this very heightened sense of awareness, that sort of perforce allows the audience to render focus to the movement, or the very absence of non-diegetic that gives that added realness, you know. So silence works very powerfully to convey that sense of isolation, at times distancing to elicit the right quantity or proportion of emotional response to a particular scene. The information is imparted as visual, and silence therefore is not simply the absence of sound any more than black is being only the absence of color, really. It traverses all manner of context. It is never absolute and achieves significance in relation to what it sort of denies, displaces, and disavows. Also, silence never ceases to impose its opposite and to sort of depend on its presence, just as there is no up and down, up without down, or there's no left without right. One must acknowledge a surrounding environment of sound or languages in order to recognize silence. You know, Tamhane, I personally feel, has created a paralanguage here. The silence which is presented is never mute, but rendered a voice through men, objects, images, urbanscapes, gestures, expressions. And in fact, European filmmakers and directors were quite aware of this dialectical role that silence played in relation to sound. I mean, Jean-Luc Godard, Federico Fellini, Ingmar Bergman, Antonioni, within their cinema, sort of rediscovered the spectrum of silence and reinforced the creation of new aesthetic modality, new procedures of sort of configuring alienation, fragmentation, absence, non-existence. I think the pervasive presence of silence in the film quote also conveys the discord, the absence of authentic communication between law and those for whom these laws are actually formulated. So the disintegration and the rupture between the written and the given is also there. Like you find in race films, for instance, the silence, it represents this articulation of difference, statement of resistance, dissent. There are silences that sort of demand to be read. Silence of caste and gendered subaltern bearing, for instance, the mention of Sharmila was made, who's sort of made to be a witness to her husband's death against her will. So that is one important use that Tamhane has made in this film. Locales is one important aspect that I find very interesting. They are as real as they can get. In fact, we as audience, as voyeurs, become integral to this one-room chawl of Kamle. We are at home with Vora in his apartment, sipping a drink with him, perhaps. Or we get into Nutan's moderately functional kitchen, and we sit in the courtroom, get on stage with Kamle. We walk these alleys, crisscrossing passageways, crowded makeshift dwellings of Mumbai shanties. And one instantly identifies with these sights and sounds around where Vora seems to visit these slums where the deceased manhole worker lived. And what is important is nothing seems concocted, nothing seems extraneous. This is how real it kind of gets. The interaction between Vora and the neighbor, you know, for instance, that neighbor of the deceased, Vasudev Pawar, the natural ease with which she's responding to his queries, you can actually hear the jingle of her bangles, you know, which is as natural a part of her conversation. The restaurant where Vora is having lunch with his parents and, of course, his sister who has just returned from the US. The unpretentious conversations between them, which normally we would have when we are on an outing with a family. The sound of the thalis, the bowls, and the glasses. I mean, they're also relatable. So I think these are very important things that he has, really employed, is made use of. And what is also important to me is how Tamhane has minutely worked on semiotics in this film. I think the use of resourceful symbols and their language is a crucial part of this film's aesthetic appeal. They are symbols that speak for themselves, and the manner in which Tamhane has dexterously exploited to reflect on culture, assertion, pride, protest, rallying cry against discrimination, which is done in this film, is generally not done in films that sort of stake the claim of calling themselves Indian cinema, I feel. And so the history, if I have to look at it that way, the history of Dalit consciousness is ultimately the history of humanity, of life, of living. And if cinema, that professes to unfurl this humanity and its layers doesn't quite well do it, its existence has no meaning. I mean, cinema has to be that medium that unravels this history. So at the very start, when the movie opens, we are presented with this huge banner, Navjeevan Vidrohi Sanskritik Jalsa, Vadgaon Hatyakand Vidrohi Sanskritik Pratihurod, which reads as Vadgaon Massacre Cultural Protest, beneath which is written, Sirf Hangama Khada Karna Hamara Maksad Nahi. Hamari koshish hai ye surat badalni chahiye. And then on the banner you see to the right is Ambedkar's image. You have Anna Bhau Sathe, Shahir Amar Sheikh, and Shahir Vitthal Umap's wife Meeratai, who's present there, who has just finished a performance when Kamle takes to the stage. So I think what is interesting is the filmmaker's sensitivity to color, which is noticeably brilliant. The flashy brightness in the shanties that gets contrasted to the hushed, mellowed lightning of the swanky bar he visits, the colors, the banners, the posters, the flags, costumes, names, places, locales, actors, all that are depicted in this film quote is a conscious attempt by Tamhane at undermining the hegemonic Brahminical symbol system, and sort of openly derides and disdains its mainstream aesthetics. In fact, we have to concede to the fact that eventually the worker was killed by man-made institutions, and Kamle was the victim of the same institutions. So just a line, and then I'll stop. Usually, when a filmmaker sort of presents a Dalit character as the lead, there is, I feel, always this danger lurking of sort of moving into certain tropes and assumptions. For instance, the camera would span around dirt, squalor, muck, the trash cans, basti, the seamer side of the underbelly, in a way denying even dignity in presentation. Rather, this very presentation then is made representation. And many filmmakers actually cannot avoid these pitfalls. But Tamhane is quite cautious, and he has permeated into it too deeply to sort of fall into that boogie trap. The film is all about manholes, as I said, manual scavenging, but we don't see the manual scavenger. We don't see the manholes. And I think such nuanced and ethical understanding is really rare. And to top it all, Tamhane has roped in people like Veera Satidhar and Sambhaji, men who are themselves symbols, emblematic of the movement. Yes.
I think Sambhaya wanted to respond. Sanjay Kumar, I know, has introduced the film earlier in EFL University, and then Vijay Borati had unmuted, so we can just have one by one all these people.
Okay.
Yeah, and also I think just now Jayanto has unmuted. Yeah, please go ahead.
Hi.
Yeah, please go ahead, Jayanto.
No, I'll take maybe 2 minutes. You see, the almost 90% of the film consists of long shots. There are maybe 2 or 3, at the most 5 mid shots, and which are also in the sense of longish mid shots. And the fact is that he is trying to create or claim for his film the indexical nature of which, you know, we were talking about semiotics. So he is claiming for his film a kind of a status of a documentary film, you know, now which itself is kind of under some kind of an attack because of its supposed and claimed objectivity, which is just not true. Even Godard was mentioned. I remember one statement by Godard when he says that in every image of the film, we must ask ourselves the question as to who is speaking, you know? So here, I am left with the feeling that it is Mr. Chaitanya Tamane who's speaking for everyone, right? And therefore, I find that his identification with the Dalit fact is that the same kind of, let us say, identification he cannot show for this middle class woman, Maharashtrian woman, who is not sophisticated, who has very strong ideas about, you know, who is guilty and who is not guilty. And she sort of has a judgmental attitude towards people. Plus the judge who is again being shown as a kind of a character who doesn't really care by putting in that part, that picnic scene at the end. So we find that here is that there is enough being said, enough and more has been said about how wonderful the film it is. I'm just trying to create a kind of a counter narrative that these are questions that one must ask about, that why is the film almost entirely in long shot? And also, why is it that we do not find a real insight into the lives of, it is again an urban, you know, I mean even the do-gooding liberal character of Vivek Gomar, you know, is something like Shelley being, you know, ineffectual poet, being an ineffectual bird, you know, flapping its wings in this thing, like Matthew Arnold's criticism of Shelley. So is there no one who is capable of certain kind of sympathy for the dispossessed classes in the society? The system is bad, the judge is bad, you know, the even this person who wants to be seen as sympathetic is actually ineffectual. He really doesn't put up a good case, you know. So what is it that we are trying to do here? That who understands them? That is only Mr. Chaitanya Tamane capable of understanding the nuances of these people in their totality, or it is just a kind of a style which is created, you know, as a documentary style by, you know, there's not a single close-up. There is the whole thing of, you know, he chooses every scene to be mise-en-scène rather than, that there is very little montage, you know. So the very choice of choosing one over the other, it means that you are choosing for a particular kind of reception for your film. And if you are choosing for that kind of a reception for your film, you should be able to answer those questions, which unfortunately he cannot. You know, it is a documentary which seizes, which doesn't even try to be objective, although it is wearing a garb of objectivity at every given point. You know. Thank you.
Yeah, thank you, Jayanto. Vijay Borati, is he here? Oh, he seems to have just gone. Sambhaya, yes, go ahead. Do you want to come in at this point?
Thank you, Nikhila.
Sorry,
Professor Aparna, I missed most of your presentation. You know, there was some technical issue at my end. Whatever that I could attend, you know, was really brilliant. Thank you so much for introducing this film. I wouldn't say that, you know, thoroughly enjoyed, but, you know, it's a true reflection of, like, the marginalized caste, you know, position, you know, not just kind of in terms of their social status, but also, you know, when it comes to the government. I remember some of these things, Ambedkar, saying the what holds, you know, independence, you know, for Dalits, you know, like, you know, they're caught between the people who discriminated against them in socially, and then, you know, in the administration, like, you know, the upper class, you know, who are sort of, you know, against the Dalit rise. So they're sort of, you know, caught between these, you know. So, you know, from the court scene, you could see that. Also, I just wanted to mention, this is a sort of, you know, some points, you know, that's all. But, also looking at that, you know, court scenes and all, listening to that, you would find that, you know, the way the judges and then the way the, you know, the lawyers actually reflect, I mean, discussing, I mean, the whole scene reflects, you know, what Ambedkar said, you know, especially that lawyers, you know, the lady lawyers, you know, with you know, these people have to be kind of, you know, kept for 20 years and so on, you know, jailed for 20 years and so on. That reflects, I mean, you know, the lack of empathy, although, you know, I think, you know, you also mentioned that, you know, these, and this is very coming from this, you know, not so, maybe one doesn't see, you know, what Karka's background, but they're, you know, very humble economic position, like, you know, ordinary cook, and then, you know, she enjoys, and, like, you know, travels and then and so on, you know, economic position. But then when it comes to, you know, Dalits, you know, what Ambedkar had said, you know, nausea, the upper caste, you know, nausea, you know, the feeling of nausea against Dalits, you know, because, you know, the moment that they have to deal with means, like, you know, they remember their religion, their status and everything. And this, that kind of, you know, very subtly reflected, you know, in their interactions and so on. And then, you know, when this lady along with her family after kind of having lunch and then she goes to a theater, you know, this, you know, first they came for, you know, jobs, you know, they took our jobs and then our girls, you know, somebody has actually, you know, done an interesting research, you know, Northern India that I shared with, that kind of, you know, came in long time ago, some 10 years ago, and that I shared with that article to Nicholas, you might kind of, you know, share. I mean, these are things, I mean, very truly reflecting. I mean, it's kind of, you know, terrifying also. For example, like, at least, you know, in that film, you know, there's a lawyer who could kind of sympathize with that guy, and then, you know, who sort of, you know, willing to argue. But, you know, for a lot of, you know, people, you know, without any support and then and so on, like, you know, life, I mean, you know, the people who are sort of, you know, conscious and who want to do something, you know, for their against caste and so on, you know, this is a sort of, you know, terrifying thing. But at the same time, you know, I don't know, it also kind of, you know, given a hope that, you know, you're not just kind of alone. There are people, you know, willing to kind of, you know, join hands, you know, and so on. Thank you. Just you know, some stray reflections.
Thanks, Sam, for those reflections. Sanjay, do you want to come in?
Yeah, actually, most of the things are already said. So just a few things which struck me in this film. The face of law, which we see here in the court, that reminds us of, you know, law as organized violence, as Tolstoy presented it.
I was about to come on that.
Yeah. law has organized violence because at a given point of time.
Break ke baad thing is not auguring well with me.
At any point of time, the ruling class is making law.
Yes.
And there are chances, in fact, that law is in conflict with the justice. So what is legal is not necessarily just. And simply because something is illegal, that doesn't mean that it's unjust. So that's the difference that we have to maintain. Yeah, I haven't finished. Okay, so this lady lawyer, she is talking about the background of the accused. But what about the background of the people who are involved in the legal system? So we see through the camera the background, or not exactly the background, but yeah, in a way, like in their private life, what they are doing after their activities in the court. So we have these two lawyers and then the judge. So I was wondering if we had already seen the judge as it appears in the last scene, had we seen already him like earlier as talking about numerology and changing the name of the child and how it will improve his health condition or the physical condition, and how wearing of gems will also improve his condition, and then talking about the students who are getting jobs, 4 lakh rupees per month and all that. So how, what kind of image we would get when we see him sitting in the court? But for that, we don't have time because this scene appears at the end of the film. Now, this dramatic performances act has been evoked. That is of 1876. Again, that reminds us of that the continuity between the continuity from the colonial period to the post-colonial period, as it has been referred by Vinay Vora in the film, that law which is already antiquated, which is already outdated, and which has been imposed by the British government for, you know, against the representation of certain plays like Neil Darpan, for example, and other, you know, which were questioning the authorities. This kind, you know, how still the authority is trying to the kind of censor or trying to block these kinds of performances which can spread awareness among the people. And we see through the pleading of these two lawyers how the rhetoric works. Again, it is not about finding the truth, finding out the truth. That is how the rhetoric was defined by Plato, that it is the art of convincing people. And it was because of this reason that Plato had a disdain for rhetoric, which comes out through the mouth of Socrates in his work, that the rhetoric is about the convincing people. It doesn't matter whether it is true or false. And finally, we see that though the power of rhetoric is not that much, because the judge is already ready to be convinced. You don't have to make a lot of efforts to convince him because of his own prejudices. So that is why I was questioning, I was wondering, had we already seen him, what we saw finally in the last scene, what kind of image we would have when he was sitting in the chair in the court? Because we see the private life of lawyers, but not the private life of the judge till the last scene. Thank you very much.
Thanks, Sanjay. Yes, Aparna, you want to come in?
Can I chip in? Because here is again where lies the problematics of interpretation in continuation to what Sanjay is talking of, legal violence, and then the, obviously what you also see is the whole problem case of interpreting the law. So unfortunately ours is a culture that sort of preferentially makes our identities static, you know, confined into categories which are often diametrically opposed to each other, with specific stereotypes sort of attached. Our standardized cultures, almost perilous habit, I must say, of interpreting is questioned here. So interpretation, actually, if we see, it sort of presupposes a discrepancy between the clear meaning of the text and the demands of the readers. It sort of seeks to resolve discrepancy. In fact, the situation is that for some reason, a text becomes unacceptable, yet it cannot be discarded, you see. So interpreting becomes a radical strategy for conserving an old text, which is thought too precious to sort of repudiate by revamping it. The interpreter or the translator, without erasing or rewriting this text, is altering it, but cannot admit to doing so, because he or she claims to be making it only intelligible by disclosing its true meaning. So with respect to the legal discourse in this film, through which this film weaves the narrative, the failure of legal activism, of course, as Sanjay has pointed out, is palpable, is tangible. And this is also critiqued through the lens of legal scholarship that sort of connects Vora, this lawyer activist, with that of being the translator interpreter. Now, the act of misreading or mistranslation cannot be innocent, I feel, because there are several living beings whose lives are very intimately connected to these interpretations, and several living beings whose lives are perhaps worse than animals, who are not even considered as living subjects. So it is this violence in the city of Mumbai that Tamane's court quotes, I must say. While it is also taking censorship, jingoism, violence, it is speaking about it loud and clear. I think a lot of warm reception accorded to it also came from the fact that students from some very good universities, we know, I mean, I don't wish to name that, were arbitrarily slapped these charges of sedition. And so in a way, what I find here, and as he has rightly pointed out, he's made one point. I don't know if that is what he meant, what Sanjay, this is referring to you. So legal activism in a way fails in court to achieve its desired end, as it's really incapable of registering what it stands for, while you know, this activism against violence tries to respond to these legal narratives interpreted within the framework of secular liberal discourses. The film sort of creates this space for interrogating such legal readings, interpretations, and translations. On one hand, of course, it works on the principle of transparency. But on the other side, there is this calcified demonstration in the police, which sort of makes it a rather incomprehensible document. Mumbai, as a city, never fails to intrigue with its rapid expansion, with its history of Dalit Panther movement, communal violence, working class mobilizations, underworld dons you have, anti-immigrant sentiments, which is very visible in that little pantomime that the family goes to see, where there is a lot of this North Indian bashing that you find. So I think it has in a way, the city on its whole has led to the production of multiple subjectivities, identities that are sort of based on race, caste, gender, ethnicity, language, religion, and these have proliferated over a period of time. Now, this film has very, very, very extraordinarily responded to this kind of urban, mesh, I must say, or networking, to sort of showcase the often unchanging patterns, practices of exclusion that are prevalent. Although it is centering around this court space, the camera keeps moving in heterogeneous spaces. You are with Narayan Kamle when he's singing Jana 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 Re Dushmanala Jana Re, or the theater where this middle class family enjoys this very parochial, I must say, bellicose kind of enjoyment, or the street, where Vora is attacked by these moral policing fanatics for dishonoring the Goimari sect. Then there are unseen spaces. You have the gutters where Vasudev inhales these poisonous gases and is forced to die. So I think all these spaces are not homogeneous. These are within the city, and they're so heterogeneous. So when Kamle is accused and this whole absurd trial begins, when all these people and spaces converge together, the process of interpretation, translation of the law begins, where language of one space seems to be thrust on the legal discourse of right and wrong, whether it's a crime, and then if it's a crime, the punishment that should be accorded. So I think the dominant narrative of legal violence, of course, that you have rests with the public prosecutor, no doubt. Her statement definitely has this very, very immense effect, because it interprets the death of the worker, which is death by accident, actually, but it's interpreted as a suicide. And also it sort of infringes upon the freedom of this Dalit activist singer who is being held responsible for making, and so he's made like the public enemy, you know, he's the enemy in the eye of the public. And this is where the logic tends to get more and more grotesque. The true meaning of Kamle's song when he sings, you know, the very, when he says this jati chi dangale, you know, caste is jungles, race is jungles, and on he goes, you know, that meaning is not understood at all, I feel. It's not deciphered because the state doesn't need to do that. It's not needed for the state. This political activism of a protagonist is bypassed as the law refuses to sort of acknowledge it. But as audience, we know that it is Kamle's anti-caste activism that has, in a way, invited the wrath, the anger of the state, which also feels the need to bridle it, you know, to nip it at the bud. And I think this, the purpose and motivation behind the song is very, very obvious. So while interpreting it in legal parlance, we find that there is no mention of caste atrocity, you see. On the contrary, the song is held to be accountable or made accountable for the sewage workers' death. So this dominant narrative is, of course, challenged by Vora, who counters the blame on the state for the pathetic condition of the worker. However, when his argument fails, what is interesting is, you know, he has to plead to the court to sort of use its discretionary measures to grant this person who is old, who is infirm, who is sick, who has been admitted in the hospital, so grant this man bail on health grounds. Thus, health ground becomes the last resort for him to sort of get the bail. So I think this is not enough. When, again, he is charged of sedition, what is brought in is his past track record, which is again pushed aside by Vora. So now the audience do not need to be told that both the accused and the deceased are Dalits, and the lawyers and the judges are from dominant castes. And yet, what I find interesting is this caste identity is not invoked. Rather, the narrative of caste gets translated into this narrative of hygiene, health, safety norms, etc., etc. So violence is not endemic only within the court, it is valorized it's not even valorized, I feel, in the shanties or the slums, but it is more in the cultural bearing, in the mindsets of the middle-class households. It is more about the middle-class households. It's more in the cultural bearing of the middle-class households. So I think...
Rishikesh had also unmuted. Rishikesh, you want to come in again?
Just a joining statement to what Aparna and Sanjay have been talking about, law and its violence, especially in court. So there are these two discourses at play, as Aparna rightly pointed out. One discourse is the one created, or let's say narrated, by the public prosecutor, played by Gitanjali Kulkarni, and the way that she reads the charges in the court is something to reckon with, because a large portion of her talk, the large portion of her reading out, is given to reproducing the law itself. So various sections of the law that have been invoked. On the contrary, the character of Vivek Gomber, who is the defending lawyer, He is invoking moments of factual information. So there are these two discourses at play within the court itself, and I believe that one of the things which Sanjay pointed out, that there is that law is both simultaneously trying to protect citizens, or it is meant to protect citizens against a certain violence, but at the same time, it is also based. It can lead to a lot of violence. I believe that Chaitanya, this particular discourse, the way that Chaitanya mobilizes it in the film to construct the courtroom interactions, is something which where violence is hinted at. It's on the fringes, it's on the margins. Because in the court, everyone, especially Veera Satidhar, and not just once, but twice, there is also this case of the stolen watch, which adds on to the absurd layer, actually. Where in the court, everyone is already a criminal. And one need not explicitly show violence. One need not make a spectacle of violence to kind of indicate the deep-seated fractures that Aparna has been pointing out. The fractures along caste lines, along gender lines, are, and in Mumbai, violence is so endemic. It is almost in the nature of the city to have this anxiety of violence on the fringes somewhere. That it eventually seeps into the narrative at a very crucial moment when the Goimari sect people blacken the face of the lawyer, and its effects on the lawyer's morale in that sense are very visibly shown. So these discourses of violence, in fact, is where court kind of transcends the documentary moment. In a documentary moment, this violence would be, as for instance, in Anand Patwardhan's documentary on the shooting in Kurla, Jaiveen Comrade and other documentaries that he has made. So violence there is something of something that the public needs to be made aware of. Whereas here, the violence is not about this documentary. The violence is more discourse. It's a discourse that people need to be aware of. That is what I felt.
Thanks, Rishikesh, for your intervention. Paniraj, sir, do you want to come in at this point?
Come in, I don't know. I need another 2 hours to counter what Aparna has said. This is too much glorification of a film, which is much hype. I am taking an extreme stand on Aparna's presentation because there are too much external points, external information being poured out into a film which doesn't contain it. Bhima Koregaon is postponed. We understand that. But too much interpretation is made out of that. And I only one question is, India Untouchable, our 14 years research to JBM Comrade, how do you posit against court? What is a point of view, as Rajini Gupta has, Dasgupta has? There is a point of view. What is that point of view and where it stands on Dalit position and Dalit subjugation point of view? That needs to be discussed much more. So, Aparna has discussed frame by frame, but I think it is too much external interpretation of the film rather than what that frames contain. So, if you want to analyze the each and every frame, I want to go with Rajni Das Gupta's point of view of long shots, mid shots, and the point of view, which doesn't support what Aparna implies for the court. I want to say that I want to go again my presentation, it caricatures a point of view on Dalit, justice for Dalits. And there is a very, very, very superficial understanding of human rights activism and interventions in this. Superficial from Kamane's point of view, that's right. Nobody denies that. But it's not just as Aparna herself has pointed out, it's not secular intervention, is not in vain and not surfacial. It is integrated into a idea of justice into society, but Thamane portrays it as if it is surfacial and he caricatures it. So many of the issues which are involved in Dalit and Dalit movement and justice for Dalits is caricatured rather than being discussed. That is one point of view I want to pose extremely at extreme argument with what Aparna has posed. That needs another set of discussion frame by frame, but I don't want to do it now because she has posited that point of view. I should counter it frame by frame, but she has put a lot of externalities into the frames of the film, which she wants us to see like that, which I doubt. That's my extreme argument. And with no disrespect to any point of view that is being expressed.
I don't want to counter what you have or your take, on all of this. I don't know whether you've been listening to what I was even saying. When I mentioned about the Yalgar Parishad, of course, it's much recent, but you cannot deny that the Kabir Kala Manch existed much prior to that. And they were also part of the organizing team of the Yalgar Parishad. Anyway, I didn't want it to get into all those details because those are very, it's better those zones are rather untrodden. But these are, of course, the sources that he has. And I don't think there are any externalities other than what Tamani has used. I mean, these cannot be extraneous. Jaibim Comrade Anand Patwardhan's documentary has been a major reference source for Tehelka's issue, has been a major reference source to get him the story of the manhole worker, right? The Kabir Kala Manch activists who are still being tried, Sheetal Sate, who was released only after it was, she pleaded on the grounds that she's pregnant, bail was granted to her, not otherwise. 6 years she was languishing in jail. Okay, and she's still fighting for her husband who's still in jail. So these are not externalities. These are sources, very raw, real sources from...
No, we know these things, but how much films frame these externalities and these...
They are very important.
That's what I said.
How can you deny their,
As if Tamane has...
I totally disagree with you. Quote is not a documentary film. So you can't expect him to go frame by frame and
show
details. Can I speak?
One by one, please.
Can I speak?
Yeah, yes.
It is not a documentary film for Tamane to go into details. There are, lots of hints, for instance, when Narayan Kamle is tried in the court and he's asked, what is his political affiliation? He says 8 years back he had, but now, it's all, which also hints at the splintered, ruptured Dalit political scenario. It's not that Tamane is not aware of it. Why are we just, digressing and talking? Externalities are important to understand these internal issues that we are talking of here. And also, to continue, with what Rishikesh has said and what my earlier point was, because I don't want to get into this zone of currents and cross currents argument and counter argument. This is my take. You may agree. You have the freedom to disagree with it or agree with it. I don't want to get into that. But in continuation to what I was saying is violence is not endemic. What I was mentioning, it's not endemic only in the courts, within the courts. Rather, you see, it is more valorized in the cultural bearing of the middle class households, the Maratha nativist tendencies that you find with its very chauvinistic claim of cultural superiority, which sort of flourishes. And Nutan is the best embodiment, the best example of this, who upholds this identity. There are shameful references in that pantomime to language, accent, food of a working class status North Indians. And then her very statement that he should be given 20 years and, put behind bar. It also brings to the fore the violence, that casteist, non-liberal middle-class attitude. So the whole claim of casteless society falls apart, that's what I was trying to come to, in fact, with this kind of interruptions that is going on. I'm not able to complete what I have to say. But what is also important is this modernist tool of rationalism also falls apart when the lawyer calls these Goimari practices as regressive, And backward and Nutan, the same woman, you know, asserts it in the name of tradition, and in broad daylight, in the name of culture, this man is attacked, he's blackened, and then, you know, so I think deaths like the death of sewage worker is an embarrassment for the state. It has always been an embarrassment for the state. And its only response is unacknowledging and reinterpreting it as suicide. That's all. And that's precisely what we see in the film. So what I was trying to point out is this film fails to recognize caste-based division of labor. And therefore, what is also at stake is the precarity of the very definition of what you understand as being human, you know, where a living human seems to be communicating with nocturnal creatures like the cockroaches in the gutters for his safety. Where the demarcation between a man and the nocturnal creature, the animals, become fragile. And this again brings back that Manusmriti analogy of, you know, animal, you know, it's one of the representations of the Dalit subjects. So the misinterpretation of the experience of caste violence really also unveils not just the inadequacy of legal activism, but the failure and even, you know, I should say the incapability of the defense lawyer to interpret it as caste violence. So that the death of the sewage worker is not marked as you know, a death due to you know, caste violence or an example of caste atrocity, but he just becomes another figure in countless many. So
Tarkeshwar has raised his hand. Please go ahead.
Thank you. It's quite interesting the discussion that is going on. So I don't see what Aparna is saying and what Paniraj is saying are two different things. I would agree with both. Let me explain how. See, Paniraj is saying within the narrative, some of the issues are not there. Yes, they are not there. It's true. But it is also true that we can't watch the film as a kind of having a blank slate. We already have certain issues. We watch the film through those issues, and when we watch those issues with these things in mind, certain things emanate from the film. So this is an interaction between what the previous knowledge that I already have and the object of the aesthetic object which I am watching. So in that process, the meaning emerges. But if you strictly do the narrative analysis or the camera shots analysis, then the meaning could be different. Let me leave it at this. Whether we can bring in our preconceived knowledge, understand it, film or not. But both are necessary to understand how the plot is moved and how to check this plot from our own experience. Both are necessary. Why I'm saying, for me, the death of the sewage worker is not even accident. It is actually a forced suicide, which amounts to murder. But forced by whom is the question. If it is the state which has to take the responsibility, which has to avoid a compensation. In order to avoid a compensation, they have to call it as an accident, and they have to call him as a kind of somebody who had taken a liquor. Interestingly, the defense lawyer, who is supposed to be a human rights activist, is taking that position of the state. The state has been taken a kind of oppressive stand here. So it is not saying it is an accident. It's saying it is a suicide and somebody has abetted the suicide. So it is trying to kill two birds with the same stone.
That's precisely where the failure of
legal... And actually, who has to take the cause of the death worker? It is actually so-called leftist organizations. Here the leftist organizations should have filed a case saying that this is the gross negligence of the municipality corporation which has led to the death of this fellow. And even if the municipality says that we have given the protection gear and other things, he has not taken it. It is his supervisor who had to ensure it before he takes up the work. So fixing the responsibility should have been elsewhere. But interestingly, the entire issue of the death of the sewage worker is gone. Now, a false case has been registered against this fellow for abetment of suicide. and the plot is focusing on that. So in that sense, yes, this issue is relegated. That is the irony that the film is showing. And this irony emerges only when you know outside of the film too. Otherwise, within the narrative, this doesn't come. But this irony comes to me because I know that what should have been the case. And it continues. The film is focusing on the court. Court is a kind of index towards the entire judicial system, how the judicial system functions. And even the so-called, the lawyer who is defending the accused in this case, he doesn't show emotions. Though he's helping that guy, he doesn't show emotions. While the people who accompany him in the police station are shouting, are trying to question back the inspector, he keeps calm because he has to argue in the court. And he has to argue in the court on the basis of what court permits him to argue and what is the acceptable argument in the court. So entire thing, what is in reality and what is happening in the court, the contrast is visible to us. And it further accentuated because it's not only about the institutions, but the people who are associated with these institutions. That's why the background of these people is shown to us. The judge, the lawyers, their family background is given to us to understand this fellow is helping because that is his profession as a who is running an NGO. But he has, at no point he shows any emotion, any urgency to push things. So nothing is there. It is, as his job is doing it. Similarly, the public prosecutor is also doing her job. Outside of the court, she is in her own world. She is neither bothered about punishing him or not punishing him. Her concerns are entirely different. And she watches a play where Marathi Manush discourse is played. And then the judge, outside of it, he has his own concerns, numerology and other things. But in the court, he appears to be, yes, your case is becoming weak because that argument is strong, only looking at the argument. So it is not vindicating any of these individuals. But together, it is vindicating, it is targeting the system. So in that sense, yes, is not any, no individual is blamed. Neither the system is also not blamed directly, but through irony, through contrast, it is shown to us. The contrast comes everywhere. Even in small things like blackening the face of the lawyer, and then there is a E at O, and then the next shot is his face is whitened. So he's in the spa, and there is a bleaching that is happening there. So that contrast is quite visible. And he goes to, he's supposed to be secular, but he and his family goes to a Gujarati hotel, have their lunch, and then when they come back, there is a security guard, and there is an attack on this fellow. The Gujarati hotel security guard, instead of helping this fellow Gujarati, he goes inside and closes the door. So the irony is something there. That is where I think it also escapes being a document. So exactly. Where there is a clever editing and putting together of things, and then the meaning emerges out of it. So I think we need to look at this kind of contrast in a new way of telling the story through the contrast, through the irony. Irony speaks, but the language of the film, the camera language, it doesn't sound like ironical. It looks like realistic. It looks like a documentary mode, but actually the clever editing is ironical. In that sense, the meaning emerges. Yes, it is true. We need to reconcile our external knowledge and also the way the plot is narrated in the movie. Both are important to keep the distinction apart, but also bring them together in the final analysis. Put them
together in the meaning itself. So, Nikhila? Just in addition to Tarakeshwar, and perhaps I will give it a full stop. There's one, aspect, of course, since Tara has been talking about irony, I thought I'd just talk a little bit and then stop. So, you have paradoxes running through and through you know, even in the way the characters are fleshed out. So what my take here is, of course, life by and large itself is wrought with multiple contradictions, and these are inherent in our day-to-day aspects. The courtroom is just a melting pot for these contradictions. It is this charnel dungeon, I must say, where hopes, aspirations, anticipations, outcomes, endless waitings, frustrations, despairs, they get doused and resurrected on a daily basis. So this panorama of futility, which sort of nears no quick end, really embodies life itself. And Naren Kamle's two songs are seething in irony, seething in satire. And the entire film is so very ironical in layers. You know? The second song where he says, you know, how blessed you are, O Lord. Paeans are sung about your courage, but this is a ballad of your kindness. I present this ballad of gratitude. How you wield the sword that states, that slashes the heart and smashes all life. Oh Lord, our master, with one shot of your gun, the best of people are downed, down in dump. Yet you did not muffle me, showed the courtesy to try me in court. What a favor you have rendered unto me. Amidst all this noise about arts, truth has lost its voice. Art is your hogwash, a deception in the name of aesthetics. Screams from the funeral pyre cannot be called a performance. We will be genuinely obliged if you do not label as artists. I think this is seething in satire. And what one perceives is both the juvenilian and the manipian variety. But what is also important is this film tends to appeal to different people for different reasons. It works for those who have already had a tryst with bureaucracy, who know how it sort of functions. It also works for those who believe in dissent, who believe that there have to be constructive debates, freedom of speech, expression, non-censorship. It also works for those who rather take a very humanistic view of life and people, even though their actions, the actions of these people may not necessarily subscribe to it. So for some, it's a statement on chicanery, on corruption of police officials, outdated laws or thoughts which have been handed down from the colonial era, very obdurate, dodged, a public prosecutor and judges, sticklers to rule, very dispassionate, very unbothered of the fate of countless innocents who are trapped in its mire on a daily basis, you know. But I think Tamane does have his last laugh. He very implicitly and very explicitly incriminates also the country's educational system, which sort of creates or produces such professionals who adapt to this rote learning pattern, you know, who perhaps lack this independent critical inquiry and thinking. And therefore, these laws are read as one would read a prose work, you see. Coming back to Tara's point, there are multiple paradoxes in this film. The resentment that is harbored by the proponents of Marathi Manus against, you know, the outsiders, not to mention, of course, with the political backing, and with very, great subtlety, I feel it has been brought out through that pantomime, which is watched by Nutan and the family. You know, I lived in Mumbai for 10 years, how in broad daylight outsiders were thrashed, on puerile grounds that they were depriving the Marathi Manus of his job, you see. So the linguistic jingoism, the ethnocentricity, or the xenophobic tendencies surrounding it all are very well processed in the film and are rightly pointed out by Tara. It's not a documentary, so you can't sort of dwell on the same thing and sort of keep detailing that. So I think, interestingly, the uproarious cheer that you find, the audience applause or the laughter, that pantomime in a way invokes on the ouster of that potential UP lover or suitor, you know, if you notice that little play, it also speaks of the so-called middle-class Marathi mindset, ironically, of course, putting it again, it is the Gujarati Gora, you know, that fights the Marathi man's Kamble's case. But the advocators of this outsider hate campaign, the Marathi Manus, you know, proponents, so to say, never could perhaps even focus on the insider's fate or sort of provide alternatives after a Narayan Kamble, who's a Marathi Manus, becomes jobless, you know, with his mill being shut down and all of that. So I think the film takes a very interesting cue from all of these, for all of these externalities, I must say. And these externalities do define what sort of works. Very brilliant interspersing of Hindi, Gujarati, English, Marathi that you find in the film. And the paradoxes within the characters themselves that you find, Nutan, her argumentative, formidable self in the court, and her domesticated self at home, the lawyer, a defender, holder of human rights, otherwise in the court, very calm, composed, reticent, back home, he's very aggressive, you know, or a judge who appears rather unbiased, you know, at face value at least, is so primitive in his beliefs outside the realm of the court. Kamble himself, the character who's so impassioned, you know, fiery on the stage, stands again as a meek, infirm person, you know, just a victim of law in the court. So absurdity is commingled also with humor in multiple places. For instance, that little incident, that little case of Mercy Fernandez, I don't know if somebody has pointed this out, but where the judge tells her that her case will not be heard simply because, she's wearing sleeveless. And that it is against the code of conduct of the court, where only modest dressing and sober colors are allowed. So I think what I find interesting is, unlike these very angst-ridden parallel cinemas of 1980s, Tariq Pe Tariq Pe Tariq and all that melodrama that it entails, the choreographed chicanery also of American courtroom dramas, if I have to put it, Tamani has a lighter touch, and he seemingly stays out of his film is not true. That is also a fact. There are many interpretations which say that he's not visible. He's not out of his film. His film is deeply, deeply political. Tamani's seditious, insidious court shows how fraudulent the right-wing rhetoric about quote-unquote outsiders is taking the jobs of Marathi Manus when Kamble himself is out of job, you know. So I feel it sort of vigorously laughs at the whole concept of, this Marathi Manus and the concept of freedom of speech, expression. And it also tells you how the British are still ruling the roost, you know, when it comes to law. So this, and of course, lots more. I mean, I can go on and on and on. It's carefully woven into the screenplay, and it ensures that court remains true to what it actually aimed. So I think all about it seems seamless and real to me. I think I'll stop with that.
Yeah, I think Monami had unmuted herself. Do you want to come in, Monami? Was it inadvertent? Do you want to come in? She's not here or what? Okay, Madam Shailaja Matartira Ivaga. Do you want to come in, Shailaja Madam?
Illa Nikila. Nanam film noda kaglila.
Okay, okay. Fine.
That's so just I'm listening.
Okay, fine. Yeah. Sridhar, anyone else who wants to come in now? Sridhar? Rajam? Arun?
Ma'am, I just want to point out one thing.
Yeah, after hearing, yes, yes, yeah, go ahead.
A very good evening to all the dignitaries here, and thank you, Aparna Madam, for inviting me to this to this wonderful lecture. Though I have not seen court yet, but I'll definitely watch it on Netflix. and the discussion entirely, it has not only, it has covered a huge gamut of subjects, the class, the caste, and it has also gone to the technical nitty-gritties of filmmaking and the and the ways of the paradigm shift of handling the court proceedings in real and in reel. But what really is intriguing and for me in this entire discussion, that the simple courtroom melodrama can assume so multifarious, so many multifarious dimensions, and in portraying the power and the powerful and the powerless. And this also takes us back to a very important Bengali film by Tapan Sinha, Adalat O Ekti Me, where this girl who gets molested by a group of boys and how and the stigma she faces in carrying out her judgment. The film also won a national award, and it is years back, but this entire discussion it brought the image of the same this movie of Adalat O Ekti Me. And there's also another film in Hindi where Talwar, where this Irfan Khan was there, where this the case, the very mysterious case of this girl getting murdered by Arushi Talwar. Yes, so if a movie on an aspect of this judiciary aspect has to be made, it has to be as bare as court, as Talwar, or as Adalat O Ekti Me, so that it brings to us the gripping drama of justice and of the injustice that takes place. So and I've also commented on the box, and thank you for making me a part of this entire discussion.
Yeah, thanks, Monami. Rajan, please go ahead. You had unmuted yourself. Rajan, please go ahead. Rajan?
I just had one or two things to say. I think that the Dalit representation is very subtle, and perhaps it might even get missed sometimes. Like in the interrogation of the neighbor of this Pawar, who was killed in this, by suicide or whatever, right? Actually, not by suicide, right? But she, this lady asked a very interesting question. Would you like to have some water, right? Now, that's something that's very interesting when you interact with the Dalit activists, etc., right? In fact, in Ahmedabad, we had gone to this Dalit Shakti Kendra, and there was a gentleman over there who started a legal aid cell for the Dalits, and non-Dalits used to come there, right? And he said, we don't charge anything, but the only one thing that you have to do is drink a glass of water with us, right? So that's something which I found very interesting and very subtly done in the movie. The other thing which was very interesting is you have Nehru and Nehru's portrait at the back, right? And the judge breaking a coconut for their trip, right? So, and the whole thing about the fingerings and not going to a doctor and all those kind of things, which are all surfacing in today's world, as we see it, the whole idea of irrationality, and which is part of our cultural heritage. And of course, they're very well brought out. So I think those are things that we should think about, because this is the third time I've seen the movie and it hasn't left me tired, right? And I would like to go and see it again, right? And definitely I will. So these are some of the things I would like to say about it, right?
Okay, thanks, Rajan. Anyone else? Anyone else? Yes, Sridhar. Sridhar has Yeah, do you want to come in or do you want me to read out what you have put in the chat box? Sridhar says, I liked Aparna's presentation and nuanced reading of the film. Only my submission is, and Professor Aparna has well argued, the film is about dissent and resistance by the civil and political society, is handled by the establishment in a muddled way, or making issue out of context. I don't quite get what this last sentence means, Sridhar. Do you want to elaborate?
You don't want to sleep?
No, it's okay. Go ahead.
See, as whatever we are discussing is actually not completely away from whatever Aparna has presented. Aparna has done a beautiful presentation. After that, I have no question. But see how the Bhima Koregaon is managed by the state. So issue is Dalits were killed and murdered after Bhima Koregaon celebrations by the Hindu Clint group, the murder group. But issue was diverted to surmised and diverted to civil and political activists, saying that they conspired to kill Modi. So in the similar manner, the activist was pinned down by the system. And how that the activist was saved by the or the around that issue, it is actually after listening to Aparna talking anything is I felt no meaning. So she has made very well presentation. In the first 40 minutes, it was beautiful presentation. She has everything in it. So I think the discussion happened after that is made it messy. Thank you.
Okay, Sridhar. Yeah, Arun, did you want to come in?
No, ma'am, not today. I think we have already exhausted.
Okay, fine. Yeah. So I think if no one else wants to come in, I think it's been a long and very intense and wonderful discussion, as we expected from a film like this, and as we expected Aparna to introduce and initiate discussion around a film like this. My own sense, yes, Tarkeshwar, you want to come in?
No, I just wanted to say thank you to everyone. I thought you are winding up.
Yeah, I not yet really. I was just thinking, when Aparna suggested this film, I was really very happy because I also thought that this is a film that many of us in the group would already have watched and probably would not mind watching again. When I went back to the film again, after watching Disciple, my own sense was Disciple was very different from Court. But when I saw it now for the second time, I saw such continuities, in terms of the discourse, in terms of the kind of critique that is made across both the films, though both the concerns are pretty different in some ways. So thanks, Aparna. So glad that you asked us to watch this film again, and so happy that we could have this discussion. Thank you all for participating in the discussion. It's a long evening. Thanks for staying and being a part of it. Thank you and good night.
Thank you, Nikhila, for having
me. Thank you, Aparna. Good night, everyone.
Thank you. It was a pleasure.
Thank you.
Yeah, thank you. Bye.
Bye. Good night.